be back in the house of the Lord this morning. Thankful that the Lord has permitted us to be here together.
Amen.
It should be a time that we can have a great time and rejoice in the fact that we're Christians, that we have brothers and sisters that we can talk to and feel close to. We're thankful this morning for these things. We want to try to study some this morning. If you would, turn to the book of John in chapter 1. And we hope this morning that as we try to teach, we feel like that that there's others besides the church that are watching. And we hope that we can be a blessing to them. What we try to teach on, and we try to study it, and we try to find references to it, and try to use it for the truth. It is the truth. It's God's word. And I know there's a lot of people out there, and I hope a lot of people are watching us this morning that will take heed, because we were put here to get ready to go.
Amen.
And we have a short time. If you live to be 100 years old, we have a short time. So we need to pay close attention to God's word. In the book of John, chapter 1, we want to talk to you just a little bit this morning concerning John the Baptist and the reason that he came. And there was one reason that he came, and that was it. I've studied, and I believe that I know for sure that there was one reason why he came. And so we're going to try to bring this point out to you this morning. But in John 1, we want to read just a little bit here where he came from. And of course, you know, John the Baptist and Jesus were second or third cousins. They lived a far piece apart, and I don't know if they ever come together and as young kids or not. But the only time that I know that they come close together was when that Elizabeth and Mary met, and there was a joyful occasion there when the baby leaped in the womb of his mother, and so I know they met that one time, or that because of Mary. But anyway, it says here in one of chapter 1 of verse 23, he's come from the wilderness, and I'm sure it was the wilderness of Jordan. But he said in verse 23 or in 22, then said they unto him, talking about to John the Baptist, who art thou, that we may give an answer to them that send us? What sayest thou of thyself? And he said, I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make straight the path of the Lord. And said the prophet Isaiah. And they which were sent were of the Pharisees, and they asked him and said unto him, why baptizest thou then, if thou be not that Christ, nor Elias, neither that prophet? And John answered him, saying, I baptize with water, but there standeth one among you whom you know not. He it is who come after me is preferred before me, whose shoe latches I am not worthy to unloose.
Amen.
These things were done in Berea beyond Jordan, where John was baptized. Now we see here, as John is buried in verse 29, the next day, John seeing Jesus coming unto him, and saith, behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the world.
Amen.
Now, he pointed him out to the people that were there. And I couldn't find any place where that they had been together or not, but he had heard of Jesus, and probably was told of him because God sent him, and because that his mother knew about Jesus, and Mary had had met with her and they had discussed this. But here, he says here in verse 30, this is he of whom I said, after me cometh a man which is preferred before me, for he was before me, and I knew him not, but that he should be made manifest to Israel. Here is the reason that John the Baptist came to this world, and we're going to get on a little bit on discussing on the baptism. But the reason here is explained to me, and it should be plain to everybody. The reason that he came was to reveal Jesus Christ to the world.
Right.
And this is the reason why that Jesus came to him. And he said to John, I need to be baptized. And John said, I need to be baptized with you. But Jesus said, no, this is to fulfill all righteousness. Now that righteousness that he's talking about was the revealing of Jesus Christ to the world. And you know, this morning, if you think about these things, until something is revealed unto you, if it be through man's mouth or if it be through the Holy Spirit, you cannot conceive it like that you would if unless it's told to you. So here is the reason why. And he said here in verse 31, and I knew him not, but that he should be made manifest to Israel. Therefore am I come baptizing with water. So he is saying, I'm baptizing with water, which don't mean as great as something that he was going to tell the people about later on. Because he said something that Jesus would do later on that would be much greater than the baptism of water. Today, this is the thing that irks me so much, is that these well-educated people that says they've been called of God will get up and teach a church, will tell anybody, hey, you've got to be baptized in order to be saved. Well, that's their problem.
Right.
But now I'll put this to you this way this morning. Jesus Christ did not need to be baptized to be saved.
Amen.
He was a perfect being, but he needed to be shown to the world and say, this is the Son of God. So we see here this morning in verse latter part of 33, and upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, the same is he which baptizes with the Holy Ghost. Now this baptizing of the Holy Ghost is a greater baptism than the baptism of water.
Right.
Because water does not do anything to a person in order to help them obtain salvation. It is not, there's nothing, and I want to make it clear, there's nothing about water baptism that will help you in the process of receiving salvation.
You're right.
So it's all in the world that it is, and it was used right here with John, is to identify to the world. And a lot of times it used to be that there was baptisms out at the river and all, and people would come. And it was that the man or the candidate that was being baptized would make a statement to the people watching, I have accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior, and I'm doing it, this baptism, to show to you that I am. And it's an open confession to the world that I have accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior. And that's baptism, and that's all it's for. It's just to represent Jesus Christ and to show to the world that you have accepted him. Now, but the thing of it is, so many people now, you ask them, well, are you saved? Yes, I was baptized down there so-and-so years ago.
Right.
Well, listen, hey, they've got the wrong end of the horse. Because, listen, they are deceived. And these people that are preaching, are teaching, baptism as any part of salvation is wrong.
You're right.
They're wrong, and I want the world to know that. And if it'll go out into the world, I want them to hear it, because listen, people need to know that they're deceived.
Amen.
They're deceived, and you take and let a person go all his life believing that, hey, that baptism sealed his salvation. He'll die in his sins.
You're right.
And so this is very important. So here he says, and John said this in verse 34, and I saw and bear record that this is the Son of God.
Amen.
So now, again, I want you to turn with me, if you would, to Matthew's Gospel, chapter 3. We want to just talk just a little bit more about John here. Matthew 3 and verse 1. In those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea. Now he was called, or he was sent preaching. And he is saying to these people here, and saying, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand.
Amen.
And this is he that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight. And the same John had his raiment of camel's hair and a leather girdle about his loins, and his meat was locusts and wild honey. And then went out to him Jerusalem and all Judea and all regions of round about Jordan, and were baptized. Now listen to this. You need to watch this. And were baptized of him in Jordan, confessing their sins. Now, these people will tell you, now listen, see what it says here? That they were confessing, they were baptized, and then they confessed. They've got it in reverse. They confessed, and then they were baptized, but here's what the Bible says. In verse 7, but when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees come to his baptism, he said unto them, O generation of vipers, who hath warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Now, who's told you, who has told you, who has preached to you the word of God, who has warned you that the wrath of God's coming? Now notice, bring forth therefore fruit meet for repentance. And think not to say within yourself, we have Abraham to our father. For I say unto you, that God is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham. And now also the axe is laid unto the root of the tree. Therefore every tree which bringeth not forth good fruit is hewed down and cast into the fire. I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance. But he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear.
Amen.
He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Here's the baptism, people, that's very important. But notice here, he says to these people, before I baptize you, you bring me forth fruit or proof that you have been saved.
Right.
So that again shows you this morning that baptism does not come before repentance. And it don't come after repentance. It's for a salvation. Now, over in John 3 and verse 5, we know this very well, but we want to bring it back to your attention. In verse 3, he's talking to Nicodemus. Jesus answered and said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Nicodemus saith unto him, how can a man be born when he is old? Now, Nicodemus was about as mixed up as these people here that's crying out, baptism is part of salvation. Now, notice, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? And Jesus answered, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Notice the thing here, it uses the word man. Notice here, He says, I say unto you, except a man be born. Now he is not talking about a spiritual regeneration. He's talking about a man being born of water. Now I hope this morning that this is not too rough on anybody that's listening. But did you see, any of you see in the last week, this giraffe that they had on the computer and how to give birth to a baby? Well, the giraffe was standing and the baby fell about 5 or 6 foot in a bag of water, and it busted and splattered all over the concrete floor. And so he's talking this morning about this man being born of the water. And that's the way that little giraffe was born. He was in a sack of water.
Right.
And he was born. Now he said here, and except a man be born of water and of the Spirit. So there's two different things. He cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of flesh is flesh. And that's what we just got through talking about, the giraffe. He was born, it's flesh, and he's born of flesh, and that's the first state of a human being into this world, is he's got to be born of his mother.
Right.
And then he says here then, that which is, and I say, except a man be born of water, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of flesh is flesh. And that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not, and this word marvel, it says, is don't be astonished. He was talking to Nicodemus here, a very intelligent man. He was a ruler, a teacher, or whatever, but he was intelligent. And he says, don't marvel at this thing that I'm telling you. He says, marvel not that I say to you, you must be born again. Hey, he says, I'm fixing to tell you, because he says, the wind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but cannot tell whence it come and whither it goes. So is every one that is born of the Spirit.
Amen.
So he is separating the birth from the mother to try and identifying the birth of the Spirit of God. There's two different ones. And Nicodemus didn't understand it. So he said, Nicodemus answered and said unto in verse 9, how can these things be?
Right.
Well, the human flesh, without the presence of the Holy Spirit, without the understanding from God, cannot understand these things. Because, listen, they accept baptism as part of this, and we've done prove that baptism has no part with this, but the thing of it is, people cannot grasp this, can't
right.
understand this. And so he says, how can these things be? Now, he said, Jesus answered and said unto him, art thou a master of Israel and knowest not these things? And so Jesus was saying, hey, you're a pretty smart person. Don't you understand this? Notice. Verily, verily, in verse 11, he says, verily, verily, I say unto thee, we speak that we do know and testify that we have seen, and ye receive not our witness. And so Jesus is saying here, hey, you just will not receive what I'm saying by faith. And so, listen, if I have told you earthly things, now what was the earthly things that he told him? Well, it was talking about a man being born of water. That's the earthly thing that he's talking about.
Right.
And he says, if I have told you earthly things and ye believe not, how shall ye believe if I tell you of heavenly things? And so he didn't understand what the earthly things were, or the spiritual things, either one, because he asked the question, how can a man be born again? But no man, and in verse 13, and no man hath ascended up to heaven, but he that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man which is in heaven. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. He told Nicodemus how that he could understand it. Right here in this, because all Nicodemus had to do was go back to the Old Testament there. And I believe it's in, I forget now what chapter, what book it's in, but he could read what had happened when the children were out in the wilderness and they disobeyed God and the snake started biting them, and Moses told God about it. God said, put up that brazen serpent on the pole, and everyone that looketh upon it will not die from the snake bite or will be healed. And here he's saying, and as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. And so he was telling them, it's all by faith.
Amen.
It's all by faith. Now, here he says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And that is the same faith that was presented when Moses put the brazen serpent up on the pole. It's the same faith as it is right now that he's talking about here. So that whosoever believeth in him should not perish. And it's all faith.
Amen.
It's all faith. So he says in verse 17, for God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved.
Amen.
It don't mention a thing in the King James Version about, but for God sent his Son, and if a person is baptized, would be saved. It don't say it, and
Amen.
They teach it. They teach it, and they keep on teaching it, and they're deceiving people. And people, you need to understand what I'm trying to tell you this
morning. Amen.
Because it's a thing that if you follow it and you keep on with it, you're going to wind up in a place that you don't want to wind up in.
Right.
Because you are depending upon something that is of man. The Bible says, for by grace are you saved through faith. And that not of yourself, it's a gift of God, so not of works or not of baptism. And so, if there's anybody that hears this and you're attending a church that's teaching baptism for salvation, you better run.
Amen.
You better get out of it, because it's wrong. And I'm trying my best to tell you this morning. Now notice in verse 18, he that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son. Just as plain as the nose on your face this morning, that's the only way that a person can be saved. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already.
Amen.
Because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation, that light is come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. When Jesus, when God said, let there be light, the darkness did not understand it. It said it comprehended it not. It did not understand it. Man today still don't understand light. They want to run to that little dark corner and hide themselves in it and say, hey, I'm safe. I brought myself here. I'm protected. And they're deceived. They're wrong. And so this is saying, he says, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds are evil. For everyone that doeth evil hateth the light. Mm-hmm. And the light was a type of the Holy Spirit. The light was a type of Jesus there in Genesis when he said, let there be light. And people still they want to shun it, they want to hate it, they want to run up and get some man's works and live their whole life depending upon what Pope John did or somebody else, one of these preachers that say that they're a Church of Christ. They teaching these things, and listen, they're dooming people.
Right.
They're dooming them. And so this morning he says, for in verse 20, for everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. But he that doeth truth cometh to the light, that his deeds may be made manifest, revealed, and they are wrought in God.
Amen.
So these are some of the scriptures on baptism, people, that you cannot deny.
Amen.
It's gospel. It's plain. And so I feel like this morning that I just felt like the Lord to teach this lesson. And I know too many people that you talk to them and ask them, hey, have you been saved? Yes, I've been saved. I was saved down yonder. I was baptized down yonder. I remember that little baptism. I was baptized. They're depending on it.
Right.
They're depending on it. And then you say, well, we know that. Yes, you do. Thank God you know it.
Amen.
But there's people maybe that's hearing this morning that don't know it.
Right.
And you pray for it, that the Lord might use this, the Holy Spirit might take and use this word to bring their attention to their misfortune, because they're in a mess.
Amen.
And they're in the danger of losing the only thing that they've got.
Mm-hmm.
And that's their soul. Because listen, you can't carry nothing with you. And the only thing that you're going to carry is going to go on before you is your soul. And it's terrible. It's a terrible thought to think about people living 50 and 60 years and thinking that they're saved.
Mm-hmm.
And they've been deceived. And the devil is just having a big time. Thank y'all so much. Pray for us. And there's